The spinner is that little circle, that little wheel of dots that sort of spins around in the video window when all of a sudden we've run out of video to play. We have not sent the video to your computer fast enough.
The buffering circle is my nemesis. It may be one of the most unwelcome animations on the internet.
The biggest problem that we're trying to attack today is how do we get rid of the spinner? How do we make it so that as you're watching a video, it never stops until you get to the end? And it's a big challenge. It has a lot of different dimensions, and there's so many things that can go wrong, and some of them are under our control and some of them are not under our control.
The buffering strategy to YouTube videos is different depending on where you watch them. In some cases, the video, you'll start to download it and off it goes. In other cases, you download it in pieces, like sliced bread. In general, we prefer to download in pieces because it lets you adapt. It means that you can decide that things are great and give people a high quality video, or you can decide that things are not going so well and you could downgrade and try to make the playback smoother.
The spinner looks the way it does. It's there just to, at least to give you some notion that we're still trying, but we don't spend a lot of time figuring out how to make it look nicer. We spend more time figuring out how to make it go away. The spinner itself is actually, it's a GIF.
It's a GIF sitting there?
Yeah, it's just a GIF sitting there, going round and round and round.
Well, it depends. YouTube videos play in so many places. There are many different versions. There are JPEGs, there are CSS animations, there are Flash animations.
When someone uploads a video to us, we then take that video and we create a whole bunch of different files out of it. And those files represent different levels of quality, different levels of bandwidth. And you can see this if you use the YouTube player. You have that little selector which says, you know, 720p, 480p, 360p, 240p. Those are all the different files.
There are some limits. But for example, if you shot a video on your phone and it's very, very small, there's not much gained by making one that's very, very large. So there are some constraints in that way.
In addition to those files themselves are chopped up into small pieces. So for each of those files, we have these pieces that represent a couple seconds of video. The actual size can vary, and that's something we play around with from time to time to see if it has any impact on the reliability of the streaming. One of the challenges that we have to deal with is getting to all these different devices that support different formats. And so we have these as, you know, MP4s, you know, using the H.264 codec. We have these as WebM files with the VP8 and VP9 codecs. We also have these as 3GP files with some other MPEG-4 codecs to reach older phones.
So not only have you got all of these videos being uploaded every day, you're then turning them into all these different resolutions and all these different file formats.
We have a pretty large set of formats and resolutions that we support at the end of the day.
So when I upload this video, how many different formats will it be existing in?
That's a really good question, and personally, I've almost lost count. it's certainly a couple dozen. Google has a lot of different data centers around the world, and we also have a network of caches that's sort of deployed with various ISPs around the world. So as you're sort of dividing up, as you're uploading this video, creating all these different formats, chopping those formats up into pieces, then you're putting each of those videos in whatever data center that may happen to have space. We're making a couple of replicas to make sure we don't lose it. And then over time, as people watch the video, it will get further distributed to different places so that it's close to where the people are watching it.
It's pretty amazing, isn't it?
It's pretty fun. It's a pretty big system. It's one of the cool things about working here is there aren't many systems like it in the world. So there's any host of things that can go wrong when we're trying to play a video. You know, it could be that you're using your computer and your computer's doing a lot of different things at the same time. It could be that you're on a Wi-Fi network that is kind of like, a little bit weak. Like, especially imagine you're at a hotel and, the hotel Wi-Fi is just, notoriously bad. It could just be that there's a lot of activity going on in your ISP and in your neighborhood. It could be that no one in your area has ever watched this video before, so we don't have a copy close by and we have to go to a faraway server to get it. The key message here is just that there's an inordinate amount of things that can go wrong, some of which we can control directly, but some of which we can't control directly. And so the best we can do, and the thing we feel very compelled to do, is work around these problems to the best we can and make them invisible to you. This is why we chop the video up into small pieces.
The thing that you connect with gathers those pieces and puts them in order so they can play back in sequence.
As you're watching the video, it's, you know, it's getting the next piece and the next piece, and it's looking a couple pieces ahead.
Well, they don't have to be in order. YouTube videos can be broken into pieces and then delivered out of order, or also you can break them up so that the audio is in one piece and that the video is in another. And so then when you watch them, the thing that you're watching puts them back together.
As it gets each piece, it's observing how fast it was able to retrieve that piece. It's like, I got this HD piece and it downloaded really quickly, so I can keep getting HD. Or it might say, the HD pieces are starting to come in slowly, and I'm not going to be able to maintain that. If I keep asking for HD, eventually, the user is going to watch the video faster than I can get the video, and you're going to have that spinner. And so then I would say, for the next piece, I'm going to go get the 480p piece or the 360p piece instead to make sure that the video keeps going uninterrupted. And of course, we do the reverse as well. It could be that you're watching the video at 360p, but we notice that it's really fast, and we say, okay, you have a really fast connection. Next time, I'm going to upgrade you to HD. Behind the scenes magic, you don't have to do anything, and we give you a better quality.
When you see the buffer spinner, we retry. We'll try to get another video that we think might play more smoothly. YouTube should just work, and you're welcome to make choices as they're presented, but you shouldn't have to. It's really up to us to try to make the video play as best it can. And what we would like to do is give you not just one that's adequate, but one that's beautiful, that's HD, has great sound, and that's our goal. And we should bring that to you. You shouldn't have to ask.
This is our responsibility to make better, and we're not done until no one ever sees that spinner. And people still see that spinner. We collect the data, we monitor the forums, we know it's still happening, and we're constantly tuning and investigating and trying to figure out, okay, if people are still seeing the spinner, why? Does it have something to do with the type of network they have? Does it have something to do with the country they're in? Does it have something to do with the video they're watching?
The relationship from people's device to the internet is probably the one that's fraught with the most variation.
One of the big challenges is the fact that we're trying to support a huge range of different types of environments. You know, everything from someone watching a video on their phone in India to watching a video on a new 4K TV with a gigabit connection in the US.
Do I feel that people blame me for YouTube performance issues? I think they do blame me for YouTube performance issues, but I think that they're correct.
I don't think there's any approach out there that's been suggested or any technique that's been out there that is probably not part of our bundle of tricks.
The burden of proof on YouTube is to work, and if the video doesn't play as you wish, then you should ask why.
It wouldn't make sense for us to walk in and say, I'm feeling like we ought to put a higher weight on something. Even if I were to feel that we ought to put a higher weight on watch time.
26, 27 zeros, and then a few ones for every single character. That is incredibly wasteful.